Welcome to our last webinar of this season. I'm always counting in seasons of, you could call it school or academic season. So the season 2019-2020 is coming to its end. And after this, both me and our speaker, which I will introduce shortly, Olaf, we will be leaving for our holidays after this session. So welcome, everybody. Good afternoon, good evening, good morning, probably. And we have Olaf Jorisma as a speaker on the topic Test as a Team Effort. Olaf is the test coordinator at Schouw Aptium. They're working on a solution called Big Solution Foodware, and test has been part of their daily practice for, surely over 1.5 years, and I mean a structural part of it, and not at the end of the line where some people after code ready, app code ready, start to do something about testing. And that's what he will be sharing with us today. How are they doing this at Schouw Aptium? So welcome, Olaf. But before I hand over to Olaf, I'll have my normal introduction to introduce everybody who hasn't been in our webinars before to a couple of things. Your microphone is muted and will not be unmuted. If you have questions, and please be welcome to post them, use the question window. I, Luc van Vught, will be your moderator today, and I will be picking up the question and pose them to Olaf. We have agreed that a question relevant to what Olaf is talking about at that specific moment, I will more or less interrupt and pose the question to him. Well, I'll do that diplomatically. So feel free to post your questions. In that sense, we are highly interactive, but we don't use your audio. And yes, if everything runs right, I will have the recording at hand after we stop this webinar, and I will process it so I can upload it to YouTube. You'll find the URL underneath, and feel free to also subscribe yourself to that. If you want to be in the know and haven't been so far, subscribe to our newsletter. Please use this URL. It's not very descriptive, but if I talk a little bit more and you haven't had it yet, you have had time to note it down. You can find me anywhere if you have questions, by the way. So don't hesitate to contact me through any other channel. And yes, normally we will list our upcoming webinars on our website, but it's a void at the moment due to, my holiday is going to start, and it will be a somewhat longer period that I'll be off, surely till the end of August, but maybe even into September. And somewhere in September, we will pick this up, and I will be communicating these new topics, new webinars on our website, and surely also share it in our newsletter. So if you have subscribed to the newsletter, you will be in the know once we start picking up for the things in the next season, 2020-2021. Before I hand off over to Olaf, I want to thank Fornaf making this possible, and they will continue to support us in the next season. So Olaf, I've finished my introduction, so I'll make you presenter right now, and you're able to share your screen and then start off.
Okay, thank you, Luc, for the introduction. My name is Olaf Jorisma. I'm working for Schouw, now an Aptium company. And I will take you through the 1.5 year trip we took with Schouw when we started to develop foodware for Business Central. Yes, and I'm working already for 4 to 5 years for Schouw, 2 years as a consultant, and now over 2 years for product development. For the presentation, I will do the why. I will show the test process, the approach we did with the tools, and some of the lessons we learned over the past year. Why do we test? Of course, we test for app source, or is there indeed more to, for the testing? This is a Microsoft part, the acceptance for the road to validation, the automated testing in Kronos with 90% code coverage. But of course, we want to make quality, we want to be upgradable, reduce risk, customer satisfaction. And as Luc always says in his course, focus on features, not on bugs. And of course, there are also some ISO regulations you can find for testing, make your product a better product for product quality and also quality in use. The first part is the technical part, the product quality on functional suitability, compatibility, security, and maintainability, of course. And for the users, we look to efficiency, satisfaction, freedom from risk, and context coverage. And how do we do it? We do it with unified engineering. That means that we not only the technical people, like the developers, are responsible for testing, but also we have product owners, tech and technical writers, which will do it together with the developer. Our developers spend between 20% to 50% of their time writing tests. Per feature, they add around 30 to 50 tests. And it, during the 1.5 year, we had a definition of done. Of course, the Microsoft code coverage of 90% was in it. It means that we also test after every slice we deliver. And we do some manual testing. The manual test we do via Azure DevOps test plans, and we use Explorer testing via a test and feedback extension, and we did that in Google Chrome because that was available at 1.5 year ago. At this moment, the extension is also available in the new Edge version. So what is a good test? A good test covers the risk, tell us the state of the code, test where the risk is, or test as close to risk as possible. And it's simple to read. It means that I am a non-developer, must read the test about the functionality. We just test one thing, and it's easy and fast to execute. Then we have the test process at Schouw. We have, during the redesign, we make test attention points. During the development time, we create the automated tests. And we also prepare the test data for the manual tests. And of course, the lead developers do a code review. After development, we do validate everything with the automated test within the Microsoft testability framework. And we also test Microsoft tests on our platform. And we use the test plans like the test coordinator and the consultants do. And the solution architects and UX designer do the exploratory testing. So if you look to the bullet points of the test phase, in the rethink phase, we already have mentioned the out of scope, the variations that are needed, and the requirements are documented. So in the next phase, we know what to test. We write the test scenarios in simple Gherkin English. I come back later to the term Gherkin English. And we mark the test scenarios as automated or manual. So we know upfront which tests need to be coded by the developers. Then we have a development phase. Of course, we make the normal code and we also write the automated tests. And of course, we do unit tests. But the developers should fix their own mess if the unit tests or tests go wrong.
If I may step in, then we have one question, Olaf. What is the criteria yes. on what you on deciding what test will be automated and what not? So what will be done manually?
Before we started, there was a lot of discussion about, let's say, setup. So do you want to need to test setup automated or manually? So in that part, we changed sometimes to manual tests instead of automated tests, because we want to test the functionality and not only setup testing. And also what we have is that some of the tests need information from outside the system, and of course the automated tests only run within in a Kronos environment, so getting information outside the system is not always easy or not cannot be made or mocked, so that's also a manual test. And the same counts for the information we send outside the system. Because we also can only test within the system.
Clear. Thank you.
Then we have the test phase. In the test phase, we run the automated tests, the manual tests. We do, of course, explorer testing. And we fix our bugs if we have. And in the release phase, we write down our known issues and our known bugs. The difference between a bug and an issue is that an issue is more something that people see when they test and they think, hey, that's nice to have, or at the moment this is out of scope, or it could be a bug, but I see it as an exotic setup, so I don't pay any attention to it for the moment, but we write it down. Then our definition of done. At the end of each release, we make a documentation of what we did, and that documentation has a functional decomposition. We have use cases. From the use cases, we derive our test scripts. We have process teams per extension, but also the end-to-end processes like sales and purchase and manufacturing. We have work instructions we make via Clickrun. And we have a demo and data script. And we have a special script we send to Microsoft so that they can test our app during the app validation. Then our approach and the tools we use. You have several flavors of testing, the test-driven development, behavior-driven development, acceptance test-driven development, and of course the scream-driven development. The highest paid person is saying that something goes wrong and we fix it at that moment. But of course, we are focusing on the acceptance test-driven development. We focus on capturing the requirements. And we do that, as mentioned, in the language we use in simple English, in Gurgen, so that non-developers also understand what we do. So we are focusing on writing acceptance tests. And of course, this is our Gurgen language. It has a given, a setup, we have a trigger, that's when you hit the button and then you hit the function. And then we have the then for verification, and that's the expectation what the code should do. So I have this is a simple example for a give and when then, just three lines on top of it, our scenario which we will test. I have a second one, also just one when, one give and one then. Then we start with the multiple givens. We have a production item, we have a sales order with the same item, also a production order exists. And you see reservation exists, BOM exists, and a production scenario is also known. The same you could have with the dance. You have one thing, one given, one when, and then many things happen in the system. So we see that an ID is incremented by one. We have a new date of date and time of sending, and the document date is also changed. And of course, it could be more difficult. Multiple givens, multiple thens, but still just one when. And this is also one of the automatic tests we have written and have coded in the system.
This looks like a big story. How does it, did it work for the well, both sides of the team? And let's say your side being more functional to get this written down on one hand, and how did it work for the developers to start understanding how to read this and implement this? Was that a long road to take?
For this test, it was indeed a long road. What we did in the execution sprints was also to make examples of the calculations the system made, and we did that in Excel, so the developer could also see at that time what he could expect of the system, and this data was in one of those examples, and I think for the first test in this app, the main issue would be set up the complete given. So you have an item, you have the production bill of material, you have a batch size calculation within it. So setting up that library for the first test was a lot of work. After that, we had several kind of tests in the same way. It took less time to make it. Yeah, but it is to set it up first is the most longer time.
I get a question from Martin Auerhand, specifically to this example. He's asking, is this an example of a regression test? I think Martin means, but step in, Martin, with an additional note if you want to, that this was or is it more a unit test? Is this a scenario in the sense of a full scenario you have to walk through in the application, or is it more reckoned as a unit test, which would be typically what a developer would come up?
I understand this question. Well, this is a more test to see if indeed the calculation goes the correct way. So it will be more, a very difficult unit test than a kind of regression test.
Yeah, a complex one.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Then the tools we use. We use two tools. This is the manual testing tool, the Azure DevOps, Azure DevOps test plans. We use it for manual testing. We use the test plans, the test suites, and the test cases. And in this setup, we also try to follow the Gherkin method, the given when then. I will do an example of it. Over here we have the test plan, then the test suite, and then on this side, on the right, we have the test cases. I just made one example. I will open it. I just do a simple test. We go to an item cart, we go to the tab warehouse, we fill in the figures for under delivery. And I added over here some parameters. This is a nice feature of the system. I did put in a few figures, the 10, the 0, and the minus 10. And I displayed if an error would come up, pop up. So the first two is no, and the last one is yes. I will show how that works. The parameters are over here. In the parameters list, you can add as many as you want and make it as difficult as you want. And then when you start up executing the test plan, you'll get multiple screens. So I want to display the execution of this test. And then we see another difference. I made two configurations in the system. At Schouw, Aptin at the moment, we only test at Google Chrome. But if you go to configurations, you could also say that you use different browsers, or and then you get multiple tests to execute in your test plan. So you have a default one and a Windows one. I will do execute one example. I do it for the web application. And I put on run. And I pop up my screen. I have to refresh it.
I'm getting hungry.
Yeah, indeed. Huh? The good pictures we had. Special colors. So the system already says, hey, go to an item cart. Well, I see an item cart. Go to the warehouse top. That's over here. It's marked green because it works. And fill in the figures in under delivery. Well, that's this field. And at first it says, hey, figure is number 10 and expected result is no error. So I will do the 10. And what you see, no error. So this part of the test is passed. At the upfront, you see the button next. And there you see the other figures, but still, of course, that works. I fill in the 0. Also, this test is passed. I go to next. I stay on the same item card. And I fill in the minus 10, and the error pops up. And what does the system say over here? Yes, there should be an error. So now the test is passed. of course, when the test doesn't pass, I can create a bug from here. I can make a picture. I even can do a video recording or add a text to everything, but I will show that in the next. And I will save and close this test. Then in runs, we can see that we did a recent test, that we completed the test, and that it was okay. So a recap of it, we use test plans. We have test suites. We can do them on a multiple level. And we have test cases. If you look to the system how we work, we have documentation, a use case. From the use case, we write the test scenario. And from the test scenario, we put it in a test case in Azure DevOps. And then, as I showed you, we follow the steps from the test case in the system. And then we say if it works or not. And we can create a bug or we just save and close it.
Olaf, a couple of questions, a couple of mine, and also from Martin Auerhand. First of all, to use this feature from Azure DevOps, do you need to have some special license for that you know of?
Indeed creating test plans in Azure DevOps, you need a special license. I don't know which license, okay. But I know that indeed people can see the test plans, but they can't make them. Yeah. So you need indeed a special license to create test plans and test suites.
Yeah. Then my second question is, and this assumes that people create test scripts in the sense of script as describing step by step, formalizing that test. It's not just exploratory testing. Somebody has to write down what needs to be happening, because otherwise you cannot make those test cases, right?
Yeah, indeed. This is the manual testing, not the exploratory. Yeah. So this is indeed, let's say made by a product owner or a technical writer. And executed.
Was that a big step? Was it a big step to take as an organization?
Yes, it was. I say yes because it's completely. It was new for our organization. Yeah. So at first when we tested the old SI footwear, we had. A big diagram with information and setup. Mm-hmm. And everybody had to do the setup themselves and then start the testing. And now we have preset test scripts in a system. We can also appoint people to them. Let's say you do this three set tests and the other one does four tests. We can follow everything in Azure DevOps. Our developers use for the repos and the pipelines. We also use it for our backlog board. So we have everything in one system. So that's why we started to use it also.
Okay. Martin had a question. they are using an external system to collect bugs and etc. They are making connections with Excel to link to all those kind of things. And he's quite charmed with this, what you're demoing with this, let's say, test manager tool from Azure DevOps. Do you have some arguments, maybe a simple one, but a couple of one, which could help him sell this tool, make people enthusiastic in his organization? What would be your way to tell Martin, this is the argument you should use for your colleagues so they're getting interested in this tool too?
Well, it's indeed a very, very good question, because up front, I tested Azure DevOps to see if we could use the test plans and could use test and feedback. I think the best way to sell it to an organization is that you have everything in one system. So everybody looks to the same screens, to the same amount of work, but also to the same test scripts. You do it in one system. In my opinion, when you work with it, it's also easy to work. There's also a lot of innovation in this system. So you see new features that even can help you to prepare your tests, or to there's now in the system to clone your test to another project, so you can reuse your test easily. And of course, if you want to use it to other systems, or you want to give your test plans to another system, there are enough APIs to unlock your test plans. So
thank you.
That's the main things why I should use for this system.
I think they're valid arguments.
Yeah. Okay. Any other questions yet?
Yeah, there's a question from Raul Nara. Let me read out loud. I haven't read it yet. So, hi Olaf, there can be scenarios which are not included initially in the test cases, but the person testing it with the test cases in front of him sees errors, issues related while testing in the customization, for which the cases were not present in the test script. Should the test script be editable by the person testing it? That's one question. The other one is, should it be open for testers to add scenarios related to the product? What is your opinion and maybe experience?
In my experience, testers should have the possibility to add the extra test they see, which is not written down, and they should add it, because then it properly is in common use. So it could be a risk if you don't test it. If you look to the especially to the next part, which I will show, the test and feedback extension, you also see that you can add a test plan or a test case in the system if you use that tool. So in my opinion, yes, testers should add extra tests, and even if the risk is very high and he's doing a manual test, then the possibility to extra automated test should be also discussed. And that's something we also did in the past and doing now. If we see a huge risk upcoming out of a manual test or an exploratory test, then we decide that it should be an automated test. And also, if we will find new bugs, at this moment we then write immediately an automated test. And then we run the test, and then we solve the bug.
Thank you. Let's continue.
Yeah. Then we used the test and feedback extension in Google Chrome. When we start at 1.5 year, only Google Chrome was available. Also, we think that if you make a global product, the main users will mainly use Google Chrome. At the moment, the new Microsoft Edge browser is also available, and that is also supported by this extension. With this extension, you can capture the screenshots. We can do a screen recording complete. You can capture notes, you can write notes when you're testing, and you can create bugs, tasks, and test plans. And if needed, you can create feedback requests. You write something down for a developer, which he has to come back to you. Of course, it can be connected or not connected to Azure DevOps. We use the connection to Azure DevOps. We have so we can immediately put bugs or tasks in the system. You can do screen recordings, you can make the notes, you can make pictures, and of course you can generate bugs and tasks. It's very easy. You just click on the button create bug within the recording, and then you can include the image actions, page load data. You just put the name it in on it, and you save it. And it looks like this. I will do a demo within a few minutes. It captures the reproduction steps. Even if you use a recording, it makes a picture of everything you do. So you have, let's say, 8 pictures in your bug report, and at the bottom you have the full screen recording, which you can download for replay. And if you open the pictures, it shows where you were. I will do the demo. I will open. So I will start. One moment. I will start from the item card. We have here the extension. You see that it's connected. This is not good, of course.
Lost the connection somehow.
There's an error, and I don't think I can solve it at the moment. Indeed, I lost the connection. I get a very large error system. I'm not happy with that, but it happens. It has to do with several accounts. So the DevOps is in the on the Appian account, and Business Central is in a different account, and then sometimes I can't connect because I have two different passwords. I'm sorry for that.
Oh.
I will move on. I can't fix it at the moment.
No, understandable. You got the slides anyway.
Yeah, I have to, indeed. That's why I have it also in the slides. Okay, back to the slides. Then as last, the lessons learned. We have tested a lot. I read some books of James Bach. And he's saying testing is evaluating a product by learning about it through exploration and experimentation. So that's what we did in the past 1.5 year. And I saw some things I want to share you with that, because we do it as a team, but also, of course, the persons in the team are very, very important. So we talk about the stories, about the people, of course, about encountering the product. How do you go into the product which you build, work together with other people, and of course the knowledge, gain knowledge about the system, but also gain knowledge about each other and how you can help each other. Of course, the work together, getting to know people, guiding others, ask for help. One of the things is that the product owner or technical writer and the developer has to make the test, especially the automated test script, together. So they need to understand each other's work and how they work. Let's say a developer codes the function, and if you write a test that doesn't hit that function at all, then the technical writer or product owner doesn't understand what it, how the system goes or how the people think about it. Of course, self-management, especially the self-criticism, look to yourself, how do you manage your work, focus on your work, but also the two lines under it, defocusing work or knowing when to stop. I know that in the past we had some release weeks, and then I think we made over 12 hours a day. And at some time when it's Thursday and you still don't think, hey, that you can release something, or you still find bugs, know also when to stop. Just make 16 hours because you think you can fix it, just stop and try to next day to finish it. Learning. Read and analyze the documentation we wrote. We write a lot of documentation, so it's a lot of things to read, but there's a lot of information in it. Overproduce IDs for the better selection. We saw that especially with the test scripts, I could easily write 200 test scripts for a few functions. And then the developer said, well, we don't hit that, we don't see that, or I just coded it, this, and then we say, okay, but we have a lot of IDs, we have a lot of test scripts, which one should be automated and which can we do by hand? So that means abandon IDs, but also in a later stadium, reusing IDs and test scripts to see, hey, we can do this test also. And then, of course, the Python testing encounter product. When you encounter the product, think also of the out of scope things. Just only do the test the things that make sense. Experiment, observe. What we also did was we didn't use all the functionality Business Central has in the past, and we now are using them. So we have to learn about, let's say, service management or directed put away and pick. Well, we all implemented that in our system, and we looked how it works together with the new features we made. And if you look to the test phases and the test strategy, of course, in the at the start, you will find a lot of bugs. Then you test more aggressively, you will find even more bugs. At almost the end of the project, you will want to make more testing, maybe even better testing. And at the end, you test careful because you want to release it, and you say, okay, I already hit all the features I expect or I have made, and I don't want to create chaos near to the release by creating much more bugs, because I like to create bugs.
Then I have a question here. that raises here. I mean, of course, if there are still a lot of bugs in the system, and you would say at the end, please be careful to find the bugs, doesn't that sound a bit conflicting?
Yes. Indeed, but I think that with the automated tests, you should have cover your complete risk. And if you then start manually testing or explorer testing, at the start you may create as much as bugs as you want, because you want to be that the system works good, and you think also that the automated test should hit the risks you are manually testing. But at the end, near to the release, I expect that your manual test and automated test cover all the risks. And if you then still have a lot of bugs, then you should ask yourself if it's the functionality is working as you want.
I have to rethink this, because I would say, if, like you say, if everything is covered by automated tests and manual testing, that's in the first two, surely, the S sympathetically and the A aggressively part of testing. Yeah. I would say at the end, like you say, everything should have been touched more or less. That's what you're implicitly saying already or saying.
Yeah.
I would just be at the end asking everybody, now bring your, I don't know what the English word for it is, but bring any tool you can bring to still try to break the system and let's see if we can still break it. Instead of being, well, bring your woolen hand gloves and only touch it meticulously.
Yes, I understand this question, but I think if you are in the process of indeed, let's say, in an execution phase, to write the code and to write the test scripts and to test nearer release, then I still think and hope that everything is already covered. Because if you have in a release week, and but what you say is of course also true, but if you have in a release week, let's say we do then idiot proof testing, and then a lot of bugs come up, then you should also ask each other, hey, did we have the scope right? Because then we see some system errors happen which we didn't expect, or we didn't test it properly.
Yeah, that's a fun. I understand some of your reasoning behind. On the other hand, of course, if I'm building a wall which should support the next level in my house, and I'm thinking I'm at the end of my time and I should be careful of touching that wall and just continue with the next floor, it would break. No. Even if I don't test, it will break while I'm using it. So I understand.
Yeah, that's
if idiot proofing testing would prove a lot of things going wrong at the end of the line. Yes, you did something wrong in the previous, let's say, testing phases. But maybe we should discuss this a little bit later. But it sounds a bit to me like we're going to send it out and don't tell us that there are bugs in it still. I would rather know I would rather know that there are bugs in the system. And that we have reported it and that we could go and send out a known issue list that, like you called, there are some exotic scenarios. Yes, we ran into a very specific, and that's what you called it when we had some talks before this session. And so you have some exotic scenario. We found that in the last phase, but that's, and we know that is exotic. So we can tell people, okay, if you do it this way, but we expect nobody to do this or whatever, that then things might go differently or wrong, differently than you expect or wrong, whatever. Yeah. So, let's leave it at this for time's sake.
Indeed, thank you. Then I go to the real lessons we learned, the developers learned, our product owners, and of course I learned. First, the developers make a library and extension with the functions of when, so you can use them multiple times. Don't place too much code between the given when then lines, because also people like me, non-developers, could read the test script. Then the test, normally, or let's say always, I should recommend to test in an environment without Kronos data. So you have an empty database, or with some tests. I know Microsoft, with all the tests they have, it also you use some Kronos data. So that's, I think, a discussion. I should deal with an empty. Make sure you always have an extra environment with data, so you can test the functionality yourself or with a consultant or product owner. what I already mentioned, the external source, try to mock it, or we make a manual test of it and look very good to the code coverage. You need to have 90%. Our functional consultants talked to me about the Gergen technique. It works good. You are triggered to think about the right things. In the beginning, we had issues to how to describe the scenarios. But what you see over there, when you sit together with the developers, you see what they have coded or how they make the code, and then it's very easy to write test scripts. It's range critical, so still we review all the test scenarios with the developers. And we still have looking for the distribution of automatic manual tests. Do you need to test all? Do you want to perform all manual tests? Do you want to perform all tests automatically? And what do you with the ones left? It's still a discussion. And it's still a discussion what we, we have planned some meetings to talk about the given when dance made by the consultants, but also how to improve it for the future. What did I learn? I learned, of course, also the Gergen technique. It's very easy to learn and understand, and will give you a good start. Also, I wrote down that developers and consultants should understand each other and indeed have to do it together, talk together, learn from each other. One of the things that sometimes needs to be done is have the developers and consultants together to put the noses in the same direction, because we see then, let's say, not enough automated test scripts written, or not enough doing manually. And of course, it helps if consultants mimic an example in the developers' environments, so they need. So that they understand what kind of data or minimum data is required for setup the tests. And that has to do with the given, let's say you take an item. Well, we work in the food, so you need a lot tracked item, and all that kind of data needs to be explained to the developer upfront. And for the future, of course, we do continuous improvement. We are busy with software handover processes. It's just Dutch standard. We are more busy with risk management during development of software. And we want to go to continuous risk management, of course. And this was my last sheet. So I don't know if there are any questions.
Yeah, there's a couple of questions, and of course, thank you very much, but I'll get back to that at the end. Question from Andrius, how do you measure the code coverage? Do you have any results or experience that you can share on that one?
No, we can't measure it at the moment. We don't do that, The lead developer is responsible for that, for the code coverage within our definition of DOM. So with reviewing the code and with reviewing the test scripts based on his indication, we say that we have enough test scripts made.
And a question or a remark also related to that from Martin Kuhn. Microsoft was not able to check the code coverage of tests in the past. Do you know whether they are now able to do that? Do you get any feedback on that from them?
I'm think that Microsoft is still busy with making a tool for that, for the code coverage.
They do have a code coverage tool, and they, as I know, but I'm explicitly asking you to. The experience is that it's not that much. Let's say there is an official criterion on putting your app to app source, where your tests should cover 90% of your code. And so they do somehow measure it. There is the code coverage tool that works together with the, let's say, the original CAL test tool, as I call that. And there you can have this test coverage map showing things, but it is not 100% proof yet. And by the way, the 90% criterion is a very ambitious one. If you get that done, but as I was told by Microsoft, don't matter too much about it. Be sure that you have your test in your app, like you also post, Olaf, and be sure that your test cover things for you, because you will be in problem and not Microsoft when things hits the fan, because you get too much bugs reported by your customers.
Yeah, and indeed, I think companies should indeed not worry about the 90%, or people also saying that the threshold is even lower than the 90%. But it's indeed about quality, and if you get a lot of bug reports from your customers or Microsoft sees a lot of issues, let's say you are not upgradable to a new version, or so then you will be thrown out of the app source, and I don't think that's something you want.
And even if you would not be thrown out, but people will deinstall your app because there are too much errors, I don't think that's what you want. We're getting to the hour. I've got one last question from myself. What is the most unexpected result of getting test into your organization? So something that happened you hadn't thought of before, and which did have, well, a quite a positive impact on daily practice at SCHAO.
I think that you are able to deliver continuous quality. So that you see that each time you run your tests on your apps, and also together with the Microsoft tests, that you see that there are not many failing tests. And I think that's something we didn't knew, because we didn't test like that. And when you start doing this, then you see the outcome, and then everybody sees the effort it took in the past year, that it has a success. Yeah.
Clear. I'm going to share the screen, my screen, to close for today. I want to thank you very much, Olaf, to share this with
thank
us.
You.
And thank everybody for being here. Yeah, if you have any questions, feel free to send in through to our email, as you can see here, webinars@ariopa.academy. If I can answer it straight away, or if I cannot, I will share it with Olaf. So be welcome to send in your questions. Olaf, thank you very much. Enjoy your summer session. And to anybody, enjoy the rest of the day. Have a good sleep tonight. And wherever you are, hope you're healthy and stay healthy in the future. We'll meet again in September, and for now, bye. Thank you very much.